announcement that the pizza's on the way. So if you're interested in pizza, it's coming. Domino's seems to be more on time than Papa John's, just a note. It's a pleasure for me to be here. My name is Robin Kirk. I'm the coordinator of the Duke Human Rights Initiative, which is a new effort that started last year on the part of faculty and students here at Duke to bring more human rights-related events, speakers, curriculum, talk to Duke University. And this is precisely the kind of event that we want to see more of at Duke, both in the law school, in public policy, in arts and sciences, everywhere at Duke, where we can have individuals who are really working firsthand in human rights work all over the world, and in particularly places like the occupied territories where the work of human rights is so important and so difficult. Our guest today is Randa Siniora, who is, there it is, thank you. So feel free to go ahead, and I'm not bothered at all by hungry people, so feel free to come down and get what you need. I'll just go ahead. Randa Siniora is very well known internationally for her human rights work, and in particular, two areas, her work on behalf of Palestinians and also her work on women's rights, in particular her advocacy for recognizing women's rights as of particular interest, and also talking about gender-specific human rights violations. In 2001, after a long career doing human rights work, Randa became the executive director of Al-Haq, which is one of the first human rights organizations established in the Arab world. Al-Haq produced some of the first studies ever written using humanitarian law to analyze a situation of occupation. And these were crucial in shaping debate on what is applicable law in the occupied Palestinian territories. By 1986, Al-Haq began taking on special projects of certain issues like women and labor rights. But it wasn't until the Intifada that Al-Haq developed into the primary source of real firsthand information on human rights and humanitarian law violations in the occupied Palestinian territories. Al-Haq's database remains the only systematized and carefully categorized catalog of human rights violations that have been committed in the occupied Palestinian territories. Since its foundation, Al-Haq has added election monitoring to its list of tasks and also investigates the human rights performance of the Palestinian National Authority. Al-Haq has had its difficulties. Just to name one, in 2002, the offices of Al-Haq were taken over by the Israelis during Operation Defensive Shield. One employee was arrested and kept in administrative detention for 3 months without charge or trial. In 1999, Al-Haq was granted special consultative status with the Economic and Social Council of the United Nations, among other affiliations that it has. And last year, Al-Haq launched an international campaign on collective punishment, considered both as human rights violations and as war crimes. So please join me in welcoming Randa Siniora to Duke.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Rob. Perhaps I need to start by thanking you very much for inviting me to speak here today. I am really honored to be at Duke University. And thank you very much for this very comprehensive introduction of my organization. And I hope today I can address with you one of the issues which have been of concern to you, to us as a human rights organization, for at least the past 25 years or more of our work. But specifically today, I'm trying to focus on one topic which I will be addressing, which is the issue of collective punishments that the Palestinian civilian population, which under international law should be considered to be protected civilians and should have the protection of international humanitarian law, and here I'm speaking specifically of the Fourth Geneva Convention, relative to times of war or under occupation. The work in the occupied territories is not so easy. We're living under a situation where there is numerous human rights violations, intensive human rights violations taking place on daily basis. This is combined with a new Palestinian Authority that also we need to have a role in doing watchdog and monitoring their actions at a time when they sometimes are being targeted by the Israeli military occupation. So it's a combination of a new Palestinian Authority not equal to a state, but also an Israeli military occupation, belligerent occupation, who is really violating every aspect of the Palestinian life on daily basis, and trying to, you know, affect the fabric of our daily lives on daily basis. In that context, I think women's rights also come as a very important component. It's very hard to look at only human rights generally without seeing the uniqueness or the impact of the human rights on women as such, as a category, because being also under a certain cultural context, in a certain cultural context, and being also as part of the generally patriarchal societies under which we all live, there's a very much different impact of the Israeli violations on women as compared to those on other members of the Palestinian society. Of course, everyone would be affected, but the impact on women being also in that cultural context and under other social constraints is another addition, and its impact on the daily life of women, I'll try to explain as I go in my presentation, would be highlighted. The campaign on collective punishment was launched in January 2004. It looks outdated now, but believe me, you know, we thought that being here on a speaker's tour, which was intended last year in October, was not realistic because there were the American elections, so we postponed it until this year. And believe me, we thought that perhaps progress will be on the peace process and that steps will be taken, that this hopefully collective punishment policy that is being imposed on the Palestinians by the Israelis will end. But what we have found out that this is much now, after over 2 years of launching this campaign, almost 2 years launching this campaign, collective punishment remains a topic that we can address very easily. I've tried to take in this collective punishment the definition of international law, specifically here again, the Fourth Geneva Convention, and this is really only one kind of human rights violations that we face in the territories. I'm not talking about all kinds of human rights violations. Based on the definition of Article 33 of the Fourth Geneva Convention, any kind of penalties that are being inflicted on an individual or a group of individuals, collective punishment could be imposed on one person also, not only on a group of people. But any kind of this kind of penalty or punishment that is being imposed on persons without they being responsible for acts they themselves have not committed is considered collective punishment. So it is enough, for example, as you see in this picture, a house to be demolished as a punitive measure. It is easy for the Israelis to come and say, a person who is a member of this family is allegedly, perhaps still not accused, allegedly accused of a political offense, and then the whole family should suffer from that. It is sometimes that the whole neighborhood could suffer from that, simply because a wanted Palestinian person is hiding in a building, or allegedly hiding in a building, of perhaps 26 or 30 flats, and because that person might be hiding in it, a half an hour notice is being given to the whole members of that, all flats in that apartment, and they have to evacuate without even taking their belongings, and the house is being demolished. There are different kinds of house demolitions in the occupied territories. There are shelling of residential areas. There are demolitions because of lack of licenses, and people build without permits because the Israelis don't give people permits to build their homes. So they go, and it's a vicious circle of building homes and then demolished or asking for permits, not getting them, and so on. So there are numerous kinds of house demolitions. What I'm talking about here is only one kind of human rights violation, which is a collective punishment. A person's home or a family's home or the neighborhood's homes could be demolished because one person is being a member of that neighborhood or a member of that family. So only punitive kinds of human rights violations. We have chosen five different kinds of collective punishments, again because I don't want to go out and speak about many of them, and because being a human rights organization, basing its arguments and getting its credibility that we are an objective human rights organization that is trying very much to address issues from international human rights and humanitarian law, the five issues that we have chosen to highlight in our work are the five issues that I'm mentioning here, and because these are very clearly cut defined issues or violations that could be classified under collective punishments. So in the thinking of a democratic state or any of the democracies in the world, a person should not be punished for acts he or she is not, has not committed. We know very well that every person is being is innocent until proven guilty. In our situation, the situation is much, much more different. The policy is that we are all guilty until proven innocent. And therefore, this basic principle under which collective punishment is based is that we are going to be punished for acts others carry out or perhaps allegedly carry out. And therefore, mass arrest simply is a person, if you happen to be in an area where there are incursions on a village or a town or a refugee camp, and you happen to be a male from the age of 15 to the age of 40 years old, it is possible that you will be rounded up in public schools, in public places, and then arrested and given an administrative detention order or an arrest, an arbitrary arrest where there are no accusations brought against you. So mass arrest is one. House demolition, punitive house demolition is another. The third one is the property destruction, which is very common in the occupied territories, the uprooting of the trees, the destruction of different kind of properties, cars, belongings of the people, and so on. And most importantly, and the two issues that are very much linked to, with each other, the movement restrictions and the annexation wall. I will try to explain why I think these are the two most clear examples, which I will focus in my presentation on them. Movement restrictions literally affects every Palestinian individual, being a child, being a woman, being a man, being an elderly. Nobody is excluded from this policy of restriction of movement. The Palestinians are living under a situation, not only are we are calling it collective punishment, but according to the United Nations Coordination Office of Humanitarian Affairs in the occupied territories, if the intent is not collective punishment, the impact that is happening to us on a daily basis is collective punishments. We at Al-Haq have enough evidence because we do first-hand documentation that this is a consistent policy aiming at punishing the Palestinian population and undermining the Palestinian people, leading to really feeling of frustration and feeling of perhaps this need of leaving the country or at least getting out of that hectic situation all the time. We are facing everyday closures. We are facing checkpoints. We are facing roadblocks, barriers, and curfews. If I want to go in depth in that, I just want to summarize simply. What I'm talking about is a situation where collective punishment and restriction of movement as one form of that collective punishment is taking place within the occupied territories. I'm not talking about restriction of movement within the occupied Palestinian territories and Israel, the 1967 Israeli-Palestinian borders. I'm talking about restriction of movement within the occupied territories. Let me give you an example. I live in Jerusalem. I happen to be a Jerusalemite. And I work in Ramallah, which is only 10 miles away from Jerusalem. I no more think of how many miles I have to cross to go to my work. That's not the point. That's not the issue. What concerns me is how many checkpoints I'm going to pass. So somebody who looks like me, privileged, perhaps I can go with my car. I cannot go with my car because it would take me much more longer to queue in not traffic jams, but in checkpoint jams. So the people do is that I have to go to work. I need two checkpoints to go and two checkpoints to come back. I need, in a 10-mile distance, to spend an hour and a half going and at least 2 hours or 3 hours coming back from my work. Sometimes, before I had my coffee in the morning, I get to work and I feel so tired because I'm queuing in what you see in this Qalandia checkpoint, which is the northern part of Jerusalem, where we are queuing in such a kind of checkpoint, and then after passing that checkpoint, we have to go take public transportation, and from that transportation, I have to go again and cross another checkpoint, and then take another public transportation before I reach my work. So sometimes I want to go back home and I don't want to start my day. It's such a difficult situation that I am trying to focus on it a little bit more because the people do not understand what is that. It is often brought about, or people outside the public opinion, the media is not showing what we're talking about. We are seeing that for security considerations, the people, Palestinian people, should be restricted from moving. The Israelis are bringing up that justification all the time. In my opinion, the Israeli government has the right to protect its own civilians. It has the right to prevent Palestinians from carrying out any kind of attacks on the civilians. We are all condemning that because we consider any civilian should be protected. There is no need but on the other hand, you don't need to punish and penalize the whole Palestinian population within the occupied territories because of that justification, which is security, which is very flexible, which has no starting point, it doesn't have an ending point. So it's like anything could be restriction of movement. So what you see on your right, for example, a structure that is being built on that same checkpoint which I pass every day. This picture I've taken that picture in September, but now this is an old picture because what is happening is that the Israelis are building a wall in front of these new constructions that are taking place and linking it with the wall over there, and therefore Palestinian Jerusalemites who are living in East Jerusalem, people like me, cannot anymore cross possibly within 2 months to Ramallah, to our work, to our jobs, which is part of occupied territory, except if I get a permit or get a visa to enter into the occupied territory, simply because Israel has annexed East Jerusalem and considered it part of Israel. And therefore, it's trying to exclude our movement and trying to restrict our movement. Despite all of that, I think as a Palestinian, I am still in a much better privileged situation than many other Palestinians who are restricted from moving around the occupied territories. Only, for example, a village near a town, a small town near the Birzeit University, maybe you heard of it, or Birzeit, is only 8 kilometers away from Ramallah. In that area, you have another 33 villages. There is a checkpoint. I mean, not all of them are checkpoints manned with police, with soldiers. Sometimes you find them earth mounds, you find cement barriers, you find other barriers. There are over 600 constructions of that sort, either manned by policemen. 60 of them are manned by Israeli soldiers. The others are blocked by cement, blocked by earth, by sand, different ways of preventing people from moving from one village to the other. And therefore, it's not only not preventing people from moving from city to city, but also within your own area, you cannot move from one village to the other. What is this happening? What is this leading to? It is really leading to breaking our communities. It is breaking our abilities to move freely within our own occupied territories, within our own areas, in order to visit our families, to go to hospitals, to go to do our jobs, to go to our markets, to practice our life as normal people. So every fabric of our life is being affected by this Israeli policy. This is the scandal I find every day when I finish the queue. Because on the other side of the checkpoint, there is no organization of this. This is every time coming in a different, coming abruptly and changing the environment the whole time. It is not also as easy as I explained. I take a public transportation. This is one of the public transportations that I need to take in order to go to my job. So it's a very difficult daily sufferings of every individual. Those kids who are going to school could sometimes need time in order to cross these barriers. Ambulances and humanitarian assistance is another way. I mean, it is not difficult to find Palestinian ambulances being prevented from moving at checkpoints and prevented from transferring the sick or the elderly or even pregnant women. According to our statistics, 60 women have already given birth at checkpoints because they have not been allowed. They had the labor at the wrong time. They have not been allowed to pass through these checkpoints. They couldn't reach hospitals. Of them, around 38 women have lost their children on those checkpoints. In our documentary, which we did for this campaign, we have focused on two women's stories, very real stories. One of them, which I would like to share with you, is that of a woman from the Nablus area, living in one of the villages around the Nablus area, which is around 60 kilometers away from Jerusalem, to the north. She had labor at a winter time in February at night, and her husband carried, you know, took her in his private car with his father-in-law in the car. They reached the main checkpoint, manned checkpoint, and wanted to enter the city of Nablus. The woman, after they passed only half a kilometer, there was heavy shooting on the car, and the man, the husband, was killed dead, completely dead, and the woman was brought before the soldiers, where she was completely stripped from her clothes and brought in the cold, while in labor for over 2 hours in front of her father-in-law, who has been also stripped off all his clothes and kept in front of him in that situation. The result was that not only she lost her husband, within the cultural context of the society, this has created a lot of other constraints on the life of that woman. The family of the dead husband have completely cut relations because it was extremely shameful for her to be in front of her father-in-law in that situation. She has been humiliated to the extent that she has been carried the burden of getting her labor in the wrong time and killing the man, and therefore all the connections with the family has been completely ended, and the baby, which was born to this mother, who is being isolated from her husband's family, and you know, even from her mother, who told me, and she says that in the film, I would have preferred my daughter to die. We go out in our, from our homes veiled, and then they put my daughter in that situation. This woman will all the time in our society, with the cultural constraints, suffer in a different way than many other women, than other Palestinians who are living in the occupied territories. What I'm trying to say is that ambulances and sick people sometimes cannot make it, only because they are stopped so long on checkpoints, and therefore they lose their life or they lose their newborn children. Curfews is another problem. I don't want to tell you how many hours, hundreds of hours that we have spent in curfews during this intifada. What is very indicative is also a case in the old city of Hebron, where there are 400 Palestinian settlers, Israeli settlers, living with 15,000 Palestinian residents of that old city. The illegal settlers are allowed to move freely in the city of Hebron, while the residents of that that city have to endure at least 372 days of complete curfew, where they were confined to their own homes in a period of 3 years, meaning that they spend 1 year of the 3 years with their children confined to their own homes because of this policy of curfews. The issue of closure and physical barriers is very common in the occupied territories. It's a daily practice. Jerusalem as well is being also surrounded by all these barriers and walls, and many of the Palestinian Jerusalemites are excluded from living in their own city where they were born, where their grandfathers were born. It is their own city, but there are restrictions on their living there. The Israelis also are building this construction of the wall, and that's why we don't call it, we don't say that this is an apartheid wall. In my opinion, some Palestinians are using the word apartheid wall. I don't use it as a human rights organization that understands really what's going on the ground. What we see is an annexation wall. It's a wall which is annexing almost, once finished, this 670 kilometers, around 10% of the Palestinian land will be expropriated, with all the water resources, with all the fertile agricultural land, and the expropriated land is mostly that area which is very fertile and used for agricultural purposes. The Israelis also are trying to exclude many of the Palestinian residents of Jerusalem. Thousands of them will be, at the first phase, excluded. Around 50,000 will be excluded from living inside their city because they have been, the wall has been built in a way where many of the population are thrown out of that way and left with the West Bank, while another 50,000 are waiting a similar act that will be taken against them. Some places, people say that there is a security fence. In places, yeah, it is not a wall of 9 meters high. It is a fence, but it is really a series of fences. And that's why I wanted to get this structure to show you. At the middle of the slide, if you see, there is a 3-meter wired fence with surveillance cameras put on it. And then you have two buffer zones of wires on the two sides of 3 meters as well. In the Palestinian side, to your left, you see a sand pit in order to track the footsteps of the people moving on that, while on the other side it's a paved road which allows the Israeli military patrols to pass and look on the... So in many of the rural areas, instead of building a very high wall, they have used this structure of a fence or a series of fences in order to close that area. But most of the cases we're seeing a similar situation like this one, 9 meters height with wires and so on, preventing the Palestinians. This is a construction that is going on. It's not yet closed. This should be completely closed, preventing people from moving from their areas. Also, beside that, the Israelis has developed with this wall a system of gates and a system of permits to the gates. On the already built structure of the wall, there has been around 60 gates put in place, because the people want to go and commute, to go to their land, to the schools, to go to their own agricultural land. Imagine that I come now and decide I want to separate this group from that group and I build a wall here. This is what is really happening in the occupied territories. People within the same community, within the same village, are isolated from each other. So the gate system supposedly is being done in order to allow the Palestinians to commute between the two communities, to go to their agricultural land. There are 25 of these gates that are open only 1 hour in the morning and 1 hour in the afternoon at the most. Meaning that if you go to that, if you're allowed into the gate and you had an emergency, you want to get out of that gate, you have to wait until 3 o'clock. If there is a woman who is pregnant and giving labor, I wouldn't advise her to be caught inside that gate, because she wouldn't be able to make it for sure. So the idea is that there is a situation of a permit system that is controlled by the Israelis. Now, not only that, it is also that this gate should only be opened if you are allowed to get in if you have a permit. And many people, for example, to get in have to have an agricultural land that is registered in their name. Many of the land in the Palestinian territories during the Ottoman period were miri land, which are publicly owned land, but have been cultivated and used by the people. Now, if you cannot prove that you own the land, you can possibly not be given a permit to enter your land and to cultivate it. The result is, after 3 years, if you don't cultivate your land, this land will be considered absentee land, i.e. state land, meaning that it could be easily expropriated and considered as absentee land, and therefore the Israelis can take it and hold it. And therefore, that's why I think the impact of the permit system and the gate system and the building of the wall is really intended to expropriate our water resources, our agricultural land, and this is why you see one of the largest water aquifers under the ground is in the western side of that wall. So what I'm talking about really very briefly is the impact of this wall on the daily lives of the Palestinians. I'm talking about cutting the Palestinians off their own communities. You know, we did lately a report on Jerusalem and the impact of the wall on Palestinians in Jerusalem. What we concluded is a title which is simply building walls and breaking communities. Simply now Jerusalem, for example, which is the most holy place for all three religions, Christianity, Islam, and Judaism. The people of the Christians and the Muslims from the other parts of the occupied territories cannot reach religious sites inside the old city of Jerusalem. In the month of Ramadan also, not only in Jerusalem, in other parts of the territories, we have the habit of having the main meal after sunset, where families always, as a cultural event, always during this holy month of Ramadan, meet together and have dinner together at the sunset time, or have their meal together at that sunset. Many of these people are no more building on the possibility of reaching their relatives who live a little bit 10 kilometers away or 20 kilometers away. Only today in the news, it was obvious that the restriction of movement on the bypass roads, which are on expropriated Palestinian land, it's like highways that have been agreed on in Oslo, during Oslo in the early 90s, between the Israelis and the Palestinians, that this land will be expropriated in order to allow the Palestinians and the Israelis and ease in the life of both Palestinians and Israelis. Now, these bypass roads, which are highways, are restricted only to the Israelis. To Israeli settlers who are living in the occupied territories. They are being connected easily within Israel, while the Palestinians have to live in prisons, surrounded by walls, surrounded by checkpoints, surrounded by barriers, and so on. And therefore, this is this is really breaking the community within the occupied territories. They are preventing Palestinians from entering, going to their jobs, to the markets, to practice their life in a normal manner. They are effectively confiscating Palestinian land and other natural resources. And most importantly, you know, all the people are talking about the withdrawal from Gaza and that the Gaza now, all settlements have been evacuated. I don't know if you are aware that there were only around 8,000 settlers in the Gaza Strip. While in the West Bank, we're talking about 425,000 settlers residing on our land illegally. Illegally, I mean, in a way that everybody is condemning the illegal settlements, Israeli settlements in the occupied territories. Now, with building the wall, the Israelis are thinking of annexing all that land in order to include at least 340,000 of those settlers, meaning that over 3/4 of those settlers will be easily connected with Israel, and there will be new boundaries built and facts on the ground that it's very hard to change. Also, they are denying the Palestinians the ability to exercise the right to self-determination. How could anybody be able to practice the right of self-determination if you don't control your, it's not only civil and political, but also economic, social, cultural, without controlling your resources, controlling your own life, and being able to carry out your life normally? It's also having a very long impact on the Palestinian community as a whole, because we're talking about psychological impact on the children and on many other sectors of the Palestinian society. The cases of the documented research and studies made on the psychological impact of the wall and the Israeli violations and collective punishments of the Palestinians reflect really dangerous results, you know. But all more importantly also, besides the psychological effect, is the really increase of poverty in the occupied territories. People are not finding jobs, they cannot commute easily, and therefore we are finding that there are 38% of the people are unemployed, of the working force are unemployed, and over 60% of the Palestinians live under poverty line, meaning living under $2 per day, according to the World Bank. So we're talking about a phenomena which was not the case. There was a political conflict always in the occupied territories. But the economic hardships on the people are daily increasing, and this is really having a long-term impact on the society. The child who is crossing this or navigating his way on over this barrier is something that I can get it very easily. It's not like I go and find an opportunity. You can find it very easily seeing children all the day coming and trying to reach their schools. According to international law, and here the Article 33, the practice of collective punishments is prohibited under international law. Anybody should not be penalized for acts or measures that they have not committed, and therefore any kind of reprisal against the Palestinians who are protected under international humanitarian law, and here I'm talking specifically about the 4th Geneva Convention, is prohibited and is not legal at all. Everyone is entitled to, I mean, these are basic principles of human rights, that you have to have a fair trial, that you should not be an independent trial, and that there should be, due process, and that nobody should be punished for acts they themselves have not committed, he or she have not committed. And everyone has the right to liberty and security and arbitrary arrest. You know, being arrested without any reasons for your being subjected to arrest is also prohibited under human rights law. The Israeli High Court, on the other hand, you know, many times we are told you are living in a democracy and Israel is allowing you to appeal to the Israeli High Court. The Israeli High Court of Justice, which is the Supreme Court in Israel, allows the Palestinians, it's true, to appeal to that court. But in most of the cases, these decisions are being dismissed and are turned out because of what they call it military necessity. In most of the incidents that we intervene to get remedy or get our own rights being compensated or so on the contrary, what we see now, a new legislation that was developed by Israel, by the Israeli Knesset, prohibiting Palestinians retroactively also from any claims or asking for compensation for any kind of violations or acts that the Israelis have carried out within the occupied territories. So the Palestinians have no resort to any kind of remedy within the Israeli judicial system. The legal obligations, on the other hand, of the international community, and this is why I have this, because this campaign that we're doing has two folds. First, to raise awareness, and this is what I'm doing perhaps with you now today. And the second one is really to pressure the governments who have signed and ratified the four Geneva Convention to undertake their legal obligations under international humanitarian law. According to the four Geneva Convention, you know, you have, if you signed and ratified the convention, and here we're talking about all states of the world, almost 192 states have signed and ratified the convention, including the United States and Israel. And despite that, we see that this convention, which calls for the protection of the Palestinian civilians, is not being implemented. The states are obliged not only to respect the convention themselves, they are obliged also to ensure that other state signatories are respecting it. What we see that they are not taking action in order to prevent the violations from taking place. And here we're not talking about a moral support to the Palestinians. We're talking about a legal obligation under international law, which the Israelis go without anybody due, of course, for political considerations or political interests, without any attention, and international law and human rights is given only lip service, if any, by the different governments. I think the Israeli practices that constitute collective punishment constitute also war crimes, and therefore we believe that these war crimes should be made accountable, and that those who are committing these violations should be made accountable in front. They cannot go ahead like that without being attended, and therefore I think now the intention is really how could we make Israelis who have committed all these collective punishments based on international law and national jurisdictions in different countries being accountable for the collective punishments, for imposing all these penalties on the Palestinians for acts they themselves have not committed. Thank you very much. Well, I'm open for any questions or any kind of interventions that you think are relevant, please.
I think it was in the Washington Post relation to a meeting with Karen Hughes.
Yes.
I don't know if you were part of the delegation who met with her.
No, on the contrary. It was, I met with the with Glenn Kessler from the Washington Post, and it coincided with that one. On the contrary, as a human rights organization, we're very much concerned that we are distancing ourselves from the Palestinian Authority, because we are also having a role of monitoring the violations by the Palestinian Authority. So definitely I was not in that same meeting, but I happened to be meeting with, because I was in Washington, met with congressmen and with the State Department, and had different meetings with the media. And it happened that the issue of Karen Hughes' visit to the Middle East was raised up, and I was commenting on a previous article and saying that in my opinion that the American administration is only giving lip service to a Palestinian state, and that a viable Palestinian state based on international law and respect of human rights really requires more than lip service, and that these words should be translated into actual deeds. Because we as Palestinians strongly believe that the American administration should do something, because other parties, I mean the Europeans, are not in the position with the balance of power around the world to do much on that. Perhaps that's why it turned out to be very, very connected, because it turned in the same quoting, in the same article. Yeah, I'll take this and
please. The extent on violations of human rights committed by Israel. However, some recent reports of the UN suggest that what Palestinian people are currently concerned with are violations of human rights considered by Palestinian factions, which actually control most of the Palestinian people nowadays, as the Israeli occupation in Gaza has come to an end and is actually loosened in other parts, and you didn't make any reference to that. I would just mention that you kept referring to Israeli actions as collective punishment. However, terrorism also amounts to collective punishment of innocent people. And obviously, the only intention, as you mentioned yourself, of the setting up of what you call the wall, and you like rightly mentioned that it's actually a fence, was to protect innocent Israelis from the threat of terrorism. And actually, Israel has been very successful in that. I mean, the numbers of fatalities in Israel as a result of terrorism have fallen since the year 2002 from about 1,000 in the first 2 years of the Intifada to less than 100 ever since. I would just point out with respect to one of the points that you mentioned that ambulances, Palestinian ambulances, have been used in the past to ferry explosives, and that Palestinian that a couple of Palestinian suicide bombers were disguised as Palestinian pregnant women. And obviously, I mean, this point was not really emphasized in your speech.
Yeah, okay. I thank you very much for your question. Well, you've raised numerous issues, and I'll try to cover them as much as I can, you know, because you've addressed them. Let me take one point. I was trying in this presentation to say indirectly, but now I want to say it directly. If the Israelis are, the Israeli government, and I said it directly, this one, has the right to protect its civilians. It has the right to take measures in order to protect the civilian population. And you know, the first thing we do is that we condemn any act of terrorism, okay, or any kind of attacks that are being, I mean, taken. You know, terrorism is a very very big word. I don't think we even, I mean, first of all, the right of the Palestinians to resist occupation is there, and they have the right to resist occupation. But I strongly believe that resisting occupation should be in peaceful means. Okay, so what I was trying to do in this presentation is trying to say if Israel wants to protect its civilian population, it is the right and the duty and responsibility of any state to protect its civilians. But let me ask you, why then that wall, which I was trying to make clear in the presentation, has not been built on the or constructed on the armistice borders of 1967, separating Israel from the West Bank? The Israelis, through my presentation, and I made it clear through clear, you know, people would tell you that they will expropriate 20% of the land or 30%. I was very accurate to tell you that they only going to take 10% of the Palestinian most fertile land. So it is expropriation of land. If the intention is security, then it is not, I don't see why this wall has not been built on the armistice borders between the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. And let me tell you, let me continue and then I explain. With regard to ambulances, and according to the International Committee of the Red Cross, which is a neutral body in the occupied territories, and with good relations with all governments, wherever they work in cooperation with the governments, including the Israeli authorities and the Palestinian authorities, and even with UNRWA and with all other United Nations bodies, it has been not proven, except in one isolated incident, that an ambulance was used for that purpose. And you imagine, you know, what you're trying to give the impression of, and this is what the media is making, you know, in often, that the whole Palestinians are carrying their belts around their waist and trying to enter into Israel and attack the civilians. You are not seeing how much attacks are, you know, you're putting the people in a situation, I don't defend them, but you're putting the people in a situation where they are hopeless, and as long as you don't resolve the core problem of continuing Israeli military occupation in the territories, then there is a problem. I want to also add, you mentioned that Gaza has been, the occupation has ended. The occupation in the Gaza Strip has not ended. The Israelis have unilaterally withdrawn from inside the Gaza Strip, and all the settlements has been dismantled. What is still happening in Gaza Strip, for your information, is that the Israelis are controlling the borders, they're controlling the skies, they're controlling the sea, and since the closure of the Gaza Strip, or since the withdrawal in mid-August, Gaza Strip was not open to the world, to traveling abroad or leaving Gaza and entering, of course, with the West Bank, there's no connection at all, for not more than 3 days at the whole. So the Gaza Strip is being confined into a very big prison. And the occupation is still controlling all the borders and have the sovereignty, have the control, and have duties towards the Palestinian population in the occupied territories. So what you're trying to represent that Israel has withdrawn from the Gaza Strip. Israel has not withdrawn from the Gaza Strip, has withdrawn from the Gaza Strip, but I believe, and this is really made clear from different Israeli newspapers and is being announced lately, that the idea is that you get out of the Gaza Strip as a trade-off for the West Bank. And the wall is not, I mean, it's not my own opinion, but it's the opinion of the most authoritative body worldwide, which is the International Court of Justice, that the wall is illegal. And it is violating both international human rights and humanitarian law. It is a decision of 15 judges, neutral judges, sitting in an independent, most authoritative body in the world and coming up with an advisory opinion on the wall. The wall is not going to bring security to the Israelis.
And the withdrawal or the decline in the number of attacks inside Israel, I tell you why. It is because there is also steps being taken. I don't want to look here defending the Palestinian Authority because this is not my intention. But there are steps being taken in order to also control the militant groups inside the Palestinian territories. It is not true that most of the people are dominated by, there are a small percentage of the Palestinians that are militant Hamas or Jihad leaders, and there are a lot of efforts being made in order to constrain these from carrying acts from inside Israel. Also, if you notice, there has been a meeting for the Palestinian leadership in Sharm el-Sheikh early this year, in order to reach an agreement on that issue. So it's not true only because the Israelis has built the wall, because there were incidents happening when the wall was being built. So, I mean, security is important for the everybody, especially for the civilian Israelis. But that, very importantly, should be seen that the hardships that it is leading to the Palestinian people, I don't see why you're disconnecting the Palestinian community and connecting the Israeli illegal settlers. You didn't mention anything about the intention of creating new borders where the Israeli settlers who are legally residing in the territories are integrated into the into Israel. So it is really, I mean, if we want to reflect on the situation, we have to be as accurate as we can, because it is important to emphasize security. But not all pregnant Palestinian women are carrying belts, and they're not pregnant. I don't understand how we can, if there was an isolated incident that happened all through the Intifada, that all Palestinian women should be put in the category that they are suicidal bombers and carrying their bombs and going around. This is not reality. The individual civilian people want to live a normal life. I don't see how you could categorize me as a mother also, or other Palestinian women, that always that we have the possibility of carrying our belts around our waist and going to carry out suicidal attacks inside Israel. That's not the what's really, this is the picture which is being reflected in the other way. I mean, I would stand against it, but it's not what's happening on the ground. And the peaceful negotiations, my dear, will bring in a just and peaceful resolution to the conflict, will bring in more security to the Israelis and the Palestinians. It is a vicious circle, you know. Sometimes you are put in a situation to think that who started it? Is it the Palestinians? Yesterday I was told it's an egg and a chicken. Which is the first? It's a vicious circle, it's true. But it's known that an occupying authority is trying to control 3 million Palestinian inhabitants of the occupied West Bank and the Gaza Strip. Being out of the Gaza Strip does not really mean that the occupation has ended in Gaza, according to scholars in international humanitarian law and human rights law, not my own opinion. There were two here. I hope I answered most of your questions.
My answer is very quick. One of the pictures that you had in your presentation had a caption. It was a cement block on a road, and it said something about the path to a holy site, that one, Rachel's tomb being blocked. And I was just looking forward. It was your very last slide, the other direction.
The other direction?
Yeah, your very last slide. Keep going. That one.
Yeah.
I was just curious, the holy site, Rachel's tomb, I don't know if there's a quick explanation of what that is.
What is it?
Can you quickly explain what Rachel's tomb is?
Rachel tombs, yeah, okay. It is a holy, the Rachel tomb is a, you know, it came to my attention, Rachel Khoury. I thought it was written on the wall, Rachel Khoury. No, this is a very holy place for the Jews on the borders of the city of Bethlehem. It is really in the heart of the city of Bethlehem, and there is a tomb for Rachel inside that locality. And therefore, this is an area which has completely been surrounded by a wall to connect it with Israel, to allow the Jews freely to come in, while many people have been stuck, you know, if you wish, from building the wall adjacent to their homes and so on. So it is a wall. Now it is. This is the first construction. Usually they start with these constructions, but then they built a wall that, like the ones that I've tried to explain to you later, which are more. They look more permanent, I think. But now the situation in that place is that here there is a Rachel tomb, and therefore they're trying to prevent the Palestinian people, and they have to go up the another to tour around in order to get into the Bethlehem city of the Bethlehem city. That's it. Thank you. Okay, please.
First of all, thank you very much, and thank you specifically for mentioning Rachel Colley. I'm a member of International Solidarity Movement myself. I was wondering about Al-Haq's position on direct action against the wall. For example, attacks on the wall, non-violent destruction of the wall. For example, cutting where it is a fence. For example, attacks that have been carried out in the area of Jayus, or Bil'in and upper areas in recent months. Secondly, I was wondering.
I didn't get exactly what's your question.
What is Al-Haq's position on direct action aimed at dismantling the wall taken by Israeli
and Palestinians? Israeli and the Palestinians that weekly demonstrate in front of the Jayus. Jayus or other places, yeah.
And secondly, I'd like you to perhaps detail some of the things that us as residents of the United States and other places in the world can do regarding the human rights violations that are going on in the territories.
Yes. Okay, the first thing, I mean, Al-Haq is a professional human rights organization, and therefore we're not grassrooted. So we don't actually go and be part of these demonstrations that take place around different walls or so on, unless we are going there. And it is very rarely to raise a human rights issue. But we are not like grassrooted organization to be able to be present at the different activities in the, near the wall or so on. Of course, there are different missions for different organizations. Some other organizations are only focused on carrying out demonstrations or working with the international solidarity movements in order to raise awareness of the wall and so on. So we are not involved in that sense. In the sense, we are more of bringing in the legal strategy and the human rights concept into addressing these issues. Of course, we think that this is another way of manifestation of not accepting the wall and the impact of the wall on the Palestinian people. But every organization or every group has a different mission, and therefore we're not part of that mission in a sense that we don't have in our tasks and objectives that we want in our objectives and tasks that we go to the field to do that kind of real daily work on the ground, because you cannot do both at the same time. That's one thing. The second thing was related to, what did you say?
What residents of the United States and other
countries? Yeah, of course, there is a lot to be done. I think there is a lot to be done with the United States. The Palestinians are very much aware, perhaps Mahmoud Abbas being today in Washington, knowing that if something should move forward, it should be the Americans. I've been meeting with different, as I mentioned, congressmen and State Department and so on. And unfortunately, what I see is a policy where the Americans are currently showing, after Hugh's visit to the area, some interest of starting a process. But my feeling is that this is a process that will start with where we will be asked, the Palestinians and Israelis, to sit around the table and discuss and without any kind of stipulations or conditions, anything. And that could be a process that is endless. So we don't want processes. And I was saying this to the American administration and people I'm meeting, that you don't want processes. You want to see steps being taken to end all these illegal issues. What I only, for accuracy, what I found at least being said to me by the American State Department is that they are very much concerned of the issue of expansion of settlements in the West Bank. And they said that they will take action on that issue. Well, on the issue of Jerusalem, they have not mentioned anything that Israel, or on the fact that Israel is creating new borders with the occupied territories, and that they're including the settlements inside the occupied territories. They were saying that they have been assured by the Israelis that this is only a temporary kind of position. So I think if you're looking at the position of the formal American administration and the American foreign policy, I think they will start processes, but they will not come to results. What I think is more hopeful is the work of civil society organizations. The movements that we see now in Europe and the United States among civil society organizations of divestment. And I'm very much with divestment. Divestment because this concept really means that you don't support and you don't allow all the financial support of companies, of entrepreneurs who want to invest in Israel if these investments are going to be used for violations in the occupied territories and assist Israel to continue with building of the wall and so on. And I think this movement is not only now developing among the church groups in the United States, but also developing among many other civil society organizations in Europe. And this is where we can perhaps find a little bit of hope in the future to change something. But I don't rely on the Americans to do much, the official policy. Yeah.
I think we have time for one more question.
Yes, okay.
So if you guys don't, anybody? If you just want to pass all of the petitions to the center this way, and I'll just walk up and get them.
Okay. Is there anybody? No, I don't think. Yeah, please.
If I'm understanding sort of the debate in this room right, it's that Israel is taking a lot of defensive measures and sort of, you would say, unilateral. Like on one side, they're taking defensive measures that aren't commensurate with the threat. And Israel would say, no, that the measures are commensurate with the threat. So my question to you is, what role do you think that Palestinians and the Palestinian government have in reassuring the Israelis that there isn't the threat there that they think that there is?
I think there is a role, of course, of the Palestinian side to take measures on that as well. And that is really what Mahmoud Abbas's policy is going on. I really, as I mentioned, I'm not very, I try always to distance also from political. I try to address issues from a human rights component. But what I know exactly is that I was told that now Mahmoud Abbas is trying to contain the militant groups inside the territories. It is very dangerous for him to start creating, you know, hitting hard, as the Israelis are expecting from him, on the Hamas and the Jihad groups. But he's trying to open a kind of dialogue and try to constrain them through agreements that we develop one strategy. And therefore, this is a benefit not only for the Israelis and delivering for the Israelis or the Americans, which is being asked from us now, because Sharon has withdrawn unilaterally from the Gaza Strip, but also in order to avoid any kind of internal conflicts within the Palestinian society. The Palestinian society is at an edge where if there are too much disputes, internal disputes and internal conflicts, that could really, you know, lead to a civil war internally within the occupied territories, and that would be really detrimental to the Palestinians. So there is a common interest on the Palestinian side and the Israeli side. The Palestinians are concerned, I think, at least the official position. And the majority of the people, I mean, not all of us are Hamas and Jihad, you know what I mean? There is a 20% between the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, 25% of them that are supporters of Hamas and Jihad. But among those also, very few are the militant. And if you negotiate with their leaders, they are pragmatic because they are intending to go into gaining power now and going into the Palestinian Legislative Council. So if you can give them some kind of power within the Palestinian Authority through being members of the parliament, of the Palestinian upcoming parliament, they would be willing to come to agreements. And this is why, for example, prior to Israeli withdrawal from the Gaza Strip, the militant groups were willing to constrain themselves from carrying any kind of attacks and missile attacks inside Israel, because they were negotiated from the former Palestinian Authority. So the best strategy, I think, is that we develop one strategy, and this is a peaceful strategy, and this is where we can perhaps gain on two sides, moving forward in delivering in order to move the peace process, but also in order to ensure that no internal conflicts take place within the Palestinian territory. Thank you very much.